camaraderie can beat that strategy.
Sometimes friendship conquers all. Friendship and love.
There you go. Love wins. Looking at what we got here. Going into picks and bans. NRG versus TSM. Who's going to be taking it? 3-2 NRG, 3-2 Team SoloMid. These guys are looking to break from that middle of the pack right now and figure out where they actually stand here in the spring split.
Yeah. Sometimes, very rarely, happened yesterday, Gangplank makes it through picks and bans. That is not the case here. Team SoloMid throws a ban at it very early.
Yeah.
The Corki ban hasn't been played by the mid lane for Bjergsen, but it has been an AD carry pick for Doublelift. Just a powerful flex marksman that they want to take away. So nothing super targeted thus far in the ban phase.
Remember the days when Doublelift used to play Urgot for the team? Really, those MLGs. It was one of the craziest games they played.
Oh, yeah.
And you talk to Doublelift, and he's like, I hated playing that.
Yeah, he hated playing Urgot.
It's like, but it was all right for you guys. Lissandra, and what will be the last one? Alistar gets taken away here, so you may still see a Kalista left up, since Ali's already gone.
Mm-hmm. Maybe a Kalista and a Lucian being left up. Mm-hmm. This could leave a Poppy or a Graves for our first pick.
Okay, so time,
or a Ryze. There are a lot of power still left in.
Poppy.
Yeah, I think Poppy is the most logical choice. Impact got dunked against Poppy yesterday.
Right.
Hauncer dunked some people last week on Poppy twice with top lane. So very important for NRG to take that away more than anything. But at the same time, that does leave jungle Graves open for Svenskeren. Or if they really wanted to, they could do a top lane Graves as well. But I think it would be a Svenskeren jungle based on the fact that you played it against Dignitas in week 2.
Be nice and aggressive on that. Keep his role. Oh, there's Mike. Can't drink.
All right, well, if they do both these, it would not be a jungle Graves. That would be a dead giveaway.
Don't game yourself. Or.
Taking away the flexibility of Graves, for sure.
So he's still top or AD.
Yeah, most likely top. I don't know if we've seen a AD Graves in pro play.
It's honestly, obviously, AD carry play him, but it's really hard to AD in a dual lane when you're trying to dodge more damage, a support, and an AD, and you're trying to get your shells in order. It's a nuisance. Top lane, where you can just be alone and crush people with your gigantic shotgun, is much more pleasing. See what this side of NRG Esports feels like they need to take on TSM. Looking at a little early game pressure, Moon keeps himself active around the map if he decides to go with Rek'Sai and her early game prowess. Lucian for Alltech. Why not? Alltech, I haven't seen him stepping up too much this year. Usually he'd be a guy that would still shine if the team were falling behind, but he's kind of leveling out a bit. See if he can start stepping up a little bit. Lucian will be the pick, and many AD carries have had quite a game on Lucian this season.
Yeah, he is. Lucian and Kalista and a little bit of Ezreal have been the top three AD carries played. So no surprise that they pick up Lucian. These are really just safe generic picks there, Rek'Sai and Lucian, especially when Elise is on the other side. Oh, this is going for that siege composition. Set out 5 traps in front of a turret, throw cocoons, and hit it with 2 marksmen. That's going to be the plan, and a very, very strong wave clear. One thing the Team Solomon's going to have here with the Graves top lane is tremendous wave clear now on at least 2 people, and that's even before seeing Bjergsen's pick.
Yep. Who has been left for the last. He will be able to counter whatever NRG Esports brings to the table. There'll be an Ahri here. They take away the Ahri from Bjergsen so he can't get in and out of these plays, maybe. Seen GBN, the Victor, quite a lot lately. He's had some success on that with Barons. That leaves a lot to chance, if that's what you're always remembering, the Barons. It didn't happen yesterday. It only happened that one time. In the one game, I should say. Happened twice.
In all of the games GBM has played, he's actually highest damage per minute of all players in North American LCS. Doublelift is number 2. Typically, you don't get high DPM unless your team actually fights frequently as well. So that could be a precursor to seeing a pretty bloody game. Is he going to go mid-zillion? I think he's going to go mid-zillion.
Now it's locked in.
Oh my god. Blind pick mid-zillion. Because now Bjergsen has play against it.
I'm just looking at the composition. I'm like, what do you want to do with this? I guess it's mostly going on Poppy, or if they can get to the back line, that's going to be Alltex. Very, very interesting composition. Definitely a lot to save that AD carry or mid laner.
That is just a very unexpected pick.
You know who does that? A guy who wears a bow tie.
Yeah, a bow tie wearer would do that. I can see that happening. No, seriously, there's been There's been one mid zillion so far, and it was in the European LCS. No, that was a zillion support, I think. This is just too crazy for me. I have seen the reserves. I've played against it a few times. It's very conditional on being able to land your skill shots. You land one bomb, you get the chain, incredibly powerful ganks, but they don't actually have very good setup for the zillion, aside from a Rek'Sai on Burrow on top of a double bomb.
That's really the interesting position as well. You're talking about kind of a siege, getting up in someone's face at a turret, but if you're going to set down traps, he's just going to throw bombs back at you, and you're not going to be able to walk it. Now that they're AoE grab, you kind of hit that area, and it sticks to you. Interesting. I'm very intrigued by this zillion pick.
So it will be a little bit terrifying being able to speed up a Poppy who will run into the team. That is a powerful thing, or a Rek'Sai. It's mainly the utility that they're going to be able to grant Altec. So this is, even though GBM has been kind of the damage carry, this is a more utility-focused pick, hugely, for these guys. He'll look to control the game through revives and move speed. But we have ourselves a zillion, guys.
We do. It's going to be an amazing matchup. We're going to see if they can kill Ian the Zillion as we get into this one. NRG Esports bringing some flavor here in week three with the Zillion mid lane. They're going to be going up against TSM. And it's going to be Bjergsen on that Victor. He said yesterday, you know, oh, I got to win on Victor. He had actually had one previously, but it just goes to show how much he kind of doesn't play that much Victor.
Yeah. Not
scary
recently.
Thing.
He's good at it. Bjergsen plays
most
things.
He's still good at it.
It's just typically in the old TSM, he'd have to be on an assassin or someone who could roam frequently. But here he was able to play the wave clear backline damage dealer. So
Let's get right into it. Before we load in, however, let us know who you think is going to see that victory screen. As always, send your votes to at LOL Esports, hashtag NRG win, or hashtag TSM win. They vote for the Zillion or vote for the victor. There will be a victor coming out of this game. And we'll see who it is. NRG Esports or TSM, 3-2 in the middle of the pack. These guys are looking to break away. We're on the rift. We're going to see some bombs.
Yeah. So this year, in the 2016 season in pro play, Zillion mid has been played once.
Once.
It was by a player called Republic over in China on NRG Pacemaker. They lost, but he did play. So that is what we have to go on for film study on mid lane Zillion. This will be fun.
That's an advantage. That's what they were looking for. That means everything. In 50 states, that's illegal. All right, so looking at the game, looks like maybe not lane swap. You see Haunts, actually everybody's meeting together. So they're confusing us even. Looking at the early game, we've seen Moon have a bit of trouble recently. Kind of slows the lanes down and whatnot. You see Svenskeren tries to get in his face on that Elise.
Yeah.
Nothing else too crazy. I'm really excited to see what for mastery keys here. Or stones, I should say.
It's also going to be very difficult to land cocoons on GBM in the mid lane. He's going to gank just because Zillion can become so fast. And Svenskeren, we'll see how he plays this. He's had definite moments of overaggression early on. But as we've been talking about, TSM has improved every game so far in the LCS. It's been very rapid improvement for them after their day one, game one loss against COG. Every game has looked a little bit cleaner. First bomb, first success. Early harass.
The TSM is also one of the teams that hasn't actually, they usually don't have to go through any roster swaps in the beginning of the season. So that is really a help. Some teams have that caveat of always switching somebody out. Storm Raider Surge.
Storm Raider Zillion. Even faster. If he lands a double bomb, he gets to zoom
fast
and resist your slows.
All right. So a little more Storm Raiders coming about. Used in the right spot. Wind speakers over onto Conquan. We've seen that a little bit more as well. What a freeze. They're not going to allow this to move forward. All types of Conquan are going to have to wait for that wave. Double bomb, but it doesn't hit Bjergsen. He tries to go in for a bit of aggression, but uses the auto onto a minion when he cannot reach GBM. That's interesting already. They're trying to get autos in and test each other a little bit. A little scuttle rebuttal. Nothing's going to happen though. Moon picks that up. So junglers know where they are. There's a bit more information going across the map to the teams now. And with that lane swap, we see both topside, Haunter, and Impact going on.
Yeah. As we watch Zillion, also We've got our crack team of researchers figuring out zillion mids. Also, Chowie played it over in the LMS. Missed that game, unfortunately. We'll see if this game starts. Lujin gets the double bomb, but his mana's running so low. Zillion eats mana early on in the game.
That's all we wanted. We're
time bombs,
super happy that he
time bombs are ranked 2 are 65 mana apiece. So if you're considering that, he also has to rewind to get the double bomb off. That's 165 mana combo, considering his whole pool. No, mana or mana is a debate that goes back through the ages. So,
mana.
I'm going with mana.
It's mana. You eat mana. It's a bread. Mana is not.
Both are acceptable, in my opinion.
Oh. All right, moving up.
Either way, the mana pool is not very high. On Zillion.
It is not. We'll see how he organizes his inventory to kind of take care of that as we move on. Sense Garen getting a little bit of counter jungling in, and we will not see Moon anywhere close. He may be on the top side here for something tricky if they keep going hard. Unbreakable goes out, not able to trade too much back. A lot of disengage as much as engage as they kind of have here in this top lane. Slows and stuns alike.
Early on, though, it is a decent-sized gold lead for TSM. The early lane matchup for the Graves, as long as he's not ganked, when he actually gets a 1v1 matchup, which is very rare, is hugely successful because he can shove into the turret so easily. Caitlyn is often picked for the early game lane dominance, which is what Doublelift and Yellowstar have been doing to Altec and Conquan. So really, across the lanes, they are asserting champion superiority as well as a little bit of skill expression, and they're getting this 500 gold lead, which is quite large for a five-minute game when no real strategical gains have happened.
Yep,
little switcheroo.
Bjergsen tries to walk into his stun, so it locks both them up. The laser comes through. Svensson Garen sweeping in with the Swifties. Early buy for him. And almost is able to get that counter gank in. Great job by Bjergsen. Play that calm and cool.
Yeah. GBM gets a little bit too close to the gravity field at the end of that.
That double flash.
Which would have hurt their DPS pretty substantially. And yeah, two flashes end up being burned by energy where it's just the heal from Bjergsen. And that triggers Svenskeren to be able to go in for a little bit of counter jungling. TSM really just winning this one through the lanes thus far.
That's what Doublelift said they would do, right? Early pressure on the lanes. He feels like he can get against Altec or get a lead against Altec and Conquan with the caliber of play Doublelift and Yellowstar can put out. Just waiting in the wings is Svenskeren here, waiting to be a pest. Impact's keeping himself in a pretty safe spot, though. You're saying all the lanes, and one we were just looking at, 52 to 36 down there is Moon. He's being relentless.
Oh,
there's
going
to be a double dive. That 3v2 in the top lane. Impact's getting hit up down here, throws on the W, so they actually can't get in any closer if Haunter were to dash for damage. And it looks like everybody makes it out alive.
Yep. Over in the top side, Doublelift had to flash.
Oh, up against the wall. Haunter gets the hurt.
Over the top side, Doublelift had to flash, but they avoided taking a huge amount of damage. And the gank failed heavily in the bottom side because Haunter smacked his Q into the turret and didn't do damage on impact.
Oh.
So it's really, really hard to dive a Poppy, and they need to back away, actually, right now.
It's just sometimes when your brain reverts to old grades and you try to fire one of those things through a wall, and you're just like, wait, that doesn't work anymore.
Yep. You need to get it just around the side of the turret. The way Impact actually positioned himself is exactly where you need to be if you're getting dove by a Graves, because Graves' Q cannot pass through walls. And again, Impact stays with mana. Nice prediction attempt, honestly, by Svenskeren, but Impact didn't flash exactly backwards. A little bit to the side.
Keeping a good Poppy up. He should be a nuisance later. We will see. Impact has avoided two ganks now, one with a flash, maybe a repeat by Svenskeren. Both Moon and Svenskeren are doing quite a bit of work here in this game. With that lane swap being matched up, usually you see a little bit more action from the junglers, and nobody's been able to come up with a kill just yet. Not a whole lot of crowd control the lanes are working with after the jungler brings it. Yellowstar could get scary here. He's on the other side of Doublelift, so he doesn't have too much aggression. He will have the W jump if Doublelift comes into range. Ba-doop. He's good to go.
Even has a couple potions, so that won't cost him too heavily. You can see Moon spending a lot of time trying to gank around because his lanes are losing. But then you check the other side of it, and Moon is actually more farmed than Svenskeren, who has spent an inordinate amount of time both mid and bottom lane. So both junglers actually behind the pace farm-wise in this match.
Seems like Svenskeren's trying to play a little bit more reactive and find Moon on his ganks. We'll have a red take here, so resources denied in that sense as Moon is towards the top side. But they may just end up trading each other's is what it will look like in the end. And also a dive here? There's a ping for Moon far behind the turret. And they're hitting the waves more than they're actually looking for damage here.
Nice tornado knockup. Yellowstar started this a little bit low, and everyone GDM. Has moved up, including the Poppy. Five man!
There's the Glacial Fissure on the Moon. He's gonna try to go right. Gets the flash out of Yellowstar. Doublelift has gotten killed. And that's gonna be another one onto Yellowstar. Persistent NRG Esports comes up with the first two kills.
Yeah, Svenskeren has been splitting the map down to the bottom side, so NRG knew there wasn't much presence up there. And also the wave clear of GBM, plus the move speed he could grant himself, let him go up there. So all five people on NRG make it to the top side. But whenever you invest so heavily on that, you wonder what you lose on the back side, because if TSM takes two turrets off of that, it invalidates the play from NRG and actually makes it a bad one. With one and a half turrets, it's actually kind of split.
Be able to do more work here. He's trying to peel Svenskeren off damage. Bjergsen only has the autos, and here comes Moon. Look like they're trying to deter it, but they don't have the resources to do so. Jonna Shield is going to nicely help that out. So TSM is actually setting things up now after that fight, though, to just be taken down, so they will be able to get it.
True. It was a 1,000 gold lead before this play. It's an 800 gold lead afterwards, so it's still a net positive for NRG. And we watched this, they were winning the 2v2 before this started, and they would have continued to win the 2v2, but TSM can't run away because they track Rek'Sai in the backside, so they leave Doublelift to die. Kongquan does a nice job of tanking the turret, and then GBM managed to lock both bombs onto Yellowstar, which gets the stun, and the kill goes over to Impact. They could have let the bomb trigger out for GBM and give it to him, or give it to Impact because he needs some power to stand up against the Graves. The kill grants Impact enough for Chain Vest.
Pretty smoothly done all around with the tanking and the kills. Everybody was able to participate and get a hand in that. We'll see how they use the wards, how they use this advantage to push forward. They're still down at gold with TSM's laning phase. We're still somewhat in here, but looking only at about 1,000 gold down. Kwan getting work done.
With the top lane Graves, he can be so much of a bully in the 1v1, which is why we're seeing this 30 CS advantage. But also, in being a bully, he's always going to be pushed up, which is why Svenskeren has been spending so much time in the red side jungle of NRG. So I actually do like the way that NRG responded to that by Moon just spending a whole bunch of time topside and then trying to kill that. Because if they're opting into the 2v2 with Graves, since Svenskeren was obviously babysitting, they're going to be inherently weaker than the guy who has the advantage in the straight up lane. So they're ganking the lanes where they can actually get an advantage, and they've ended up to trade somewhat equally. It's been the rest of it that's granted the larger advantage for TSM.
Little plays like this opening up windows for them. Svenskeren, Yellowstar, kind of going support jungle route now as they walk around together, keeping it safe. And yes, the crowd is happy about the vision this game.
Rambunctious crowd today.
Rambunctious indeed. Making their own action if there isn't any produced just yet. All tech. Walking into a pretty dark jungle. There we go. They got some wards now to their shoulder side on the left. No real push. Teleports up for Haunter. He actually may get ganked here in the top lane in just a few if he stays along with Impact. But that's going to give pressure to the bottom. If they do see Moon top lane, this could be a second tier turret at the bot.
Yeah, so Impact trying to get the poke down, but ends up taking more himself. Moon in the ward.
Yeah.
It's also difficult to dive at Graves. We talked about how it's hard to dive at Pop. He gets a lot of armor and MR from his dash. Plus, it's a dash, so he gets to run away pretty easily. This could be a fair bit of turret pressure, however.
Yeah, they're calling for assistance in the bot lane. Put the flag down. It's taking shots with a Caitlyn there. Much, much easier to get hits on the turret. Even Svenskeren's focusing a few. Great focus here. And Yellowstar is able to
protect them. How many turret shots is Doublelift going to take?
Enough to almost kill him. About 150 HP right there. It's a good thing that was Bjergsen rotating down behind them and not GBM.
Yeah, not a great play there by Doublelift.
What was he saying in that video before he started the game?
There's actually a recurring trend of Doublelift taking too many turret shots. It's happened in a fair bit of times. Maybe he turns his game sounds down and just doesn't hear the turret ping. Who knows? Just lock camera, no sound. That's how Doublelift plays AD carry.
He just hears how good he is while he's playing. 131, 115, 119. Definite leads. Cleaned it up.
Double pink wards here that are undefended, so NRG actually have an opportunity to clear away. Pretty valuable vision, but they don't get the one in the other brush, unfortunately. Had the right recall timings. They could have swept in a little deeper, probably should have. But they are content with four pink wards in the bottom side of the map now. Four energy, so you can really telegraph a team's intent by where the pink wards are going. They want, since they've already taken the top turret, they need to reprioritize to the bottom side in gate control.
Knowledge
but
on
there
blue.
Go two of the pinks. That hurts.
They left them to kind of just die. Ready to place them. TSM was ready to take them. So this is Dragon going over. 13 minutes. TSM keeping good pace on the game for things that they want, whether it's a turret or this Dragon. Also getting some nice ward clearing in. This is helping Garrison get bigger. His 148 there is almost built up on his first item. The core is already hit here. Haunter's got his Yomba's Ghostblade in. He's going to be providing quite a bit of damage in that solo lane. We've already seen Impact have a bit of trouble there, but they're the same level, so should be okay overall. Shouldn't see anybody just get killed just yet.
Yeah. It's another one of these TSM games where the early game progresses very slowly. Mm-hmm. Yesterday against Cloud9, we didn't see First Blood until about 18 minutes, but then the game was over 10 minutes later. See if this game follows a similar trend. Even though we've already had a few kills, we haven't seen a first big team fight.
Oh dear.
We'll wait until it's over, then do the dash. Goodbye.
And now you're left alone. Do you actually want this? Oh, the wall. Okay, that was close. That moment where you're about to like gasp. Svenskeren and Haunter, they are safe.
And this sets up a pretty good push for Haunter though, because Impact has lost his ultimate and a lot of his health, which could mean a third turret early for TSM. The relentless wave clear is really adding up here.
He stays.
He's bluffing right now. Impact is playing like he has Rek'Sai right next to him, even though Rek'Sai is a little bit far away. Mm-hmm. Bluff buys him a little bit of time.
There's a ward trigger, but I don't think it saw him. It was just within range. Turret goes down. They have nothing to gain off of that, so they decide to pull back. Haunter, once again, having a good game. From Poppy now to Graves on that top side. It was really only the first week we saw him kind of fall behind on some Gnar play and that Shen. Now he's, oh, I'm sorry. Wrong game. Looking at it. He had the Mundo and Poppy. I'm sorry.
Mainly showing a lot of flexibility.
Yeah.
Because he's gone from hard tanks in week one with Mundo and Tahm Kench.
Yep.
Then Poppy, which is a new power pick. Then straight back to Lissandra and Graves, which are really three fairly distinct playstyles, and he's shown success on all of them, which is very difficult to do at a pro level. And one of the main reasons TSM talks up Haunter, because now they think they have every position can play any style, which gives them the ultimate mm-hmm. level of flexibility. It's the goal for TSM.
Back in the day when that gravity was being put together, I kind of asked Sane, I was like, was this Haunter guy? Is the real deal? It took him a while, shake those nerves, figure out what the stage meant. When he's found it, he's definitely be able to put up some consistent games from that top lane. GBM clearing away some minions. He's got the blue buff, so no problem for him just yet. Both teams trying to be resilient right now from really giving too much up. Mid turrets to be dropped on the side of Team SoloMid. Might be able to open up the map for energy here. Still kind of not confused, but interested to see how they engage or kind of make things start to work for themselves on the side of energy.
Yeah. Wondering when they're going to start playing the team fights with this Zillion, because they can get some nice positional advantages. And it's very conditional on the skill shots from GBM. But now that he has his tier and his Roa, it's kind of the Zillion yep. set of core items. And they're on. I just want to get some CDR. But he tremendous zone potential with these bombs. And also, since Impact does have the kill and has been keeping up and catching up pretty well.
Oh.
There he goes.
Well, blam! Slap. Oh, the flash over the top of Impact. That's going to be the teleports coming in now. Four members of TSM to four of Energy. And it's a run up from Doublelift. He'll be late on this one. Altec has joined the fight. Monsoon is healing. Altec, very, very dangerous spot there. Almost eating the Chaos Storm up front. But the rest of the team's able to back up. And Yellowstar's able to get vision.
GBM ended up using his ultimate in that engagement as well, yep. so he no longer has the revive, which will lead to a rotation here from TSM. TSM didn't take very much damage, but they're trying to set up a play. So is NRG, who is behind them.
That's on Scuttle. We're at 17 minutes here. There's no home guard to come in, but you do have the Zillion speed up, and they are going for double lift. This is going to be his second death of the game if they can get him to go down. It looks like they pressure it just enough. You can see what their focus was. Make sure he's down. Don't even worry about anybody else.
That's the move speed right there. Impact came in from the backside, and GBM continued to track. Even though he didn't have his ultimate up, they knew they had the numbers advantage.
Right.
And this could be a very scary combo with an unstoppable impact flying into fights.
I like that. Sounds like a skill we actually have.
Unstoppable impact?
Unstoppable impact. I know it's force. I know it's Malphite. I understand we have one. Maybe we should just change the name. Looks like NRG not letting this wave go too far. They have eyes on the prize, and that's going to be mid-turret. It's also Bjergsen, though. They want the bag of chips on the side. Up, over, ping-pong, into the turret. Kangquan living with a sliver of health. And I don't think they're going to get the turret, but they did get something out of it. Turret actually in the bot lane by Altec with that pressure, rather.
They lead with the exhaust, and then just pile in with their move speed advantage. GBM making this Zillion pick get picks.
Yeah.
Throughout the game, and they're pulling back 4-0, but still down in gold, just to kind of go to show you how much farm advantage and turret edge TSM has so far. One turret, and the rest would be counted by farm.
Well, with the way it looks, they have the potential for no deaths, especially if the Zillion starts saving people. Mm-hmm. Manage to get themselves in and out of fights, like you said, with that positioning. Oh, so helpful when you can get super, super fast. One of the reasons, actually, along with the health, Lulu is such a nuisance in game. And Altec, 179. 20 CS behind right now, but it's not seeming to affect energy.
Yeah, I would say that TSM has a decently built composition to go against a Zillion, because one of the greatest strengths of a revive passive is the ability to just bring someone back from a single target focus. But Graves and Victor both have a lot of AoE damage. And that's what you want against someone with something like a Kale Ultimate or a Zillion.
Who do I
choose? To have multiple people dying at the same time, which makes it really difficult to choose.
Wow.
TSM makes a nice jump to the Dragon there, but Energy is going to try and push up the mid lane. So TSM made it to the Dragon faster, and now it's all about whether they can make it mid in time, which I think they can.
It looks like it happened. The wave wasn't pushed. Energy was actually pulled into the fight just a little too fast.
The wave, they get the stun on double!
There, they're going in. Yellowstar is able to get in front. Haunzer taking damage as well. Now they're back. Bjergsen double lifted Haunzer, trying to stay behind Svenskeren. Stay healthy, but there's so much to go across that front line, and bombs that can just be thrown over the turret.
Yeah.
That zoning potential you were talking about coming in big.
That was very unexpected for Doublelift, I imagine, but he's unable to dodge the bomb skill shots, and it leads to a powerful...
Oh, that's going to be real bad. That's Bjergsen this time. Knocked up, ping-ponged once again. Moon is saved by the ultimate. They rewind time, and they are going to be able to take down the turret.
Double again!
Another kill. Doublelift does get caught this time, and it is the end for him. 30 seconds on the clock for these death timers, and Energy is just stomping around the map right now.
Well, Doublelift has spent the last minute dead, and this is a chain of events that TSM just can't seem to recover from.
You said both of these teams kind of had the same idea in mind, and that's the siege. And right now, they are going through everything. They have these goggles that don't even show turrets, and they're just diving diving over and over again. They've gone through the batting order twice now.
Yeah. Almost just a back-to-back ace, just not full kills, about seven kills in a push, one after the other, and this gives Energy a gargantuan lead. They just turned it on. GBM went on a rampage with stuns. Everyone else was following it up as well. And where are we even going to start with this one? This is after Doublelift had died. They get another double stun. It stuns Svenskeren because that's within the range of the double bomb stun rage, which kills Bjergsen and keeps Svenskeren low. But TSM just was unwilling to cut their losses. Perfect timing on the revive, right as the collateral damage was going to hit. And then the corner of the wall to kill Doublelift, who had just walked back and who should not have been there since the turret was already lost and he needed to be ready to set up the second inhibitor.
Right.
And that just led to more and more kills. At this point, TSM's in some serious trouble.
What a game. GBM with fadeaway bombs, making plays. All attack, go pretty hard. Didn't really know it was on the other side of that turret. And he does see a majority of the team across the map, so he wasn't too scared. The rest of the team as well following in that confidence as they take down a second tier. Chat, over and over again, we mentioned at the beginning of this one, these games kind of back and forth, and then it's a snap in one direction.
Yeah, at
right
least
now,
right here.
Energy has that.
And TSM had been looking better in each game up until this point, where they're looking like they have a little bit of a relapse, but mainly it's Energy bouncing back big from their defeat yesterday against Team Liquid. This surprise Zillion pick from GBN is working wonders, and it's the rest of the team backing him up as well. We said we wanted all tech to step up. Well, they heavily ganked his lane this game. Doublelift is now sitting at 0-3.
There's that 4-0. Speed. Oh, Doublelift instantly getting hit up by the Culling and more hits. Impact is in. GBM, he just gets
still alive.
Range. Still alive. Comes back. He's going to be right on top of a trap, however. He flashes out, and they have used so much to try and kill Impact. But they also use quite a bit to get in and out on that on energy side. That does not bode well for TSM.
How deep can you dive while still surviving?
He had scuba gear on that time.
We have not found out yet, because that was clearly not far enough to be too far. They get out. They don't really get any objectives out of that one. So it was a failed dive, so to speak, but they're just not punished with a kill. The shutout's still intact. 10-0.
It takes a lot of balls to dive that team, to dive a Glacial Fissure Braum and all the stuns and CC they can put out. Well, I guess they didn't. It was just Impact.
GBM just built an Aegis on mid-Zillion. Never have I ever seen GBM build Aegis.
That's his bow tie for the skin.
Oh, dear. Just trying to get Baron Vision, but a little bit too far out of position against Janazillion, Poppy, Rek'Sai.
At this point, you got to have a warding buddy.
Yeah, or just use your blue trinket before you go to ward.
There you go.
Too much distance to cover, though. Only so many blue trinkets.
Oh, fancy feet.
Oh, can they get him in the chain stun?
Ultimate's there. Ultimate's on.
He got it off
before the tent locked on. The gravity field hit him up. That's a huge shield he gets as well. Conquan keeps him alive. Moon goes in the front to try and be a pest, and he does. He creates a meat wall that starts taking everything. The cocoon just misses, so no follow-up from Bjergsen on the other side to any squishy targets. He would have had a nice route to the back line there. But looks like TSM tries to now push down mid lane. No wave. They're just trying to create pressure and keep energy kind of cordoned off here.
Definitely.
That was intense for a second.
It was really tricky. The gravity field didn't chain perfectly with the stun, which gave a fraction of a second for GBM to self-catch his ultimate. But that was a bit of a power play for TSM. Really unfortunate for them that they did not get a kill. The tankiness of GBM added to that, thanks to his itemization. They're looking for a chase down
here.
This
is pretty good. This is a full energy coming out now. Impact using a bit to get himself move forward, create more pressure, and now is this the time that TSM backs is their pressure onto Baron for energy here, because they don't have many waves to work at this point.
I do need to speak to GBM's build briefly, though, because he's gone for the high income support build, essentially. He's done heavy mana building since he needs to be able to cycle all of his spells with the Roa and the Seraphs.
Yeah.
But aside from that, he's not looking to multiply his damage any farther. Now he's just going utility items with the Aegis of the Legion. So it's essentially the ideal build you'd want on a support if the support had the gold of a mid lane. He's filling a very supportive role and relying on the base damages of Zillion to get his job done, which is pretty cool. I have not seen much mid Zillion, as no one has.
Max Q, was it Max Q, W?
It was Max Q, then Max W,
right,
then the E, which is now, even at rank 3, a 70% haste or slow. And when he revives people, since he still does have 331 ability power from the Roa and the Seraphs,
you get
the revive at rank 2 will bring people up with 1,500 health. So pretty much a second life.
So no wonder they're really utilizing that on Impact, because you get to utilize all the HP there. And you get the most out of it with his resistances back there. Interesting. They've definitely been very strong. No hesitation in going in on a lot of these ganks. Right now they're really testing, or trying to get TSM to test the waters, I should say. They're saying, just walk a little bit closer. The fog of war is safe, I swear. It's warm in here.
It's fine.
So like they have times to have GBM to clear wards by himself, and there's no chase because he's so fast. There's these little things that can keep toying with TSM right now, and it puts TSM in a bad spot when energy can get that close. They are not on a Glacial Fissure they want to be on right now, taking a bit too much damage without being able to follow up on that. And it looks like energy, once again, pulls back, but it really just looks like these are soak-up fights here. If they can't get it, they can just stand there and absorb everything.
Yeah, it would be a little worrying with the Aegis onto the Zillion and the supportive build. Does energy have the damage? It's a full tank Rek'Sai, a Poppy, and then an empowered Lucian. So Altec are going to have to do the lion's share of the overall damage of these fights, unless GBM lands some really perfect bombs. And despite not having a kill, TSM is still holding their own in some of these fights. It means, really, NRG's just going to continue to try and pick people off. But if they fail to do so, there's a chance they could lose a straight-up team fight.
I've never really seen a team pull the trigger this much. They are itching to get a kill. But luckily enough, they actually have not let it get them in a bad spot. They continue to pull back when things get into a sticky situation to keep themselves safe. 11-0 right now. And there's been quite a bit of fighting in this game. Now they're going to start on to Baron, most likely again to pull TSM and get a few of those spells out over the wall. That's going
to
be Yellow Star and also Svenskeren in a bad spot. Yellow Tech going on to Yellow Star, wasted calling on Unbreakable, but he might actually still get the kill. Flash forward and he gets the passive light, and it's going to be Haunter going down now. No, he gets a True Grit out of that light, and it looks like the team continues to kite on. This time they can follow up. Double Lift gets pushed up against the wall. Moon's going to try to get in for more crowd control, and he's actually already out of the ground and cannot provide it. They're just waltzing around. It's like they're not even worried about TSM's damage or how they're going to try to counter this fight.
Oh.
Everybody's alive on the side of NRG, and they are looking to take down Svenskeren to finish off this fight. He's got
enough
speed up in just a second. Oh, that's enough.
Now 15 kills to zero.
Chaos.
TSM is getting overpowered by NRG's utility right now. They can't quite take people down. Everyone's getting away with slivers of health. And still the game, still 15 kills to zero. This is the closest 15 kill to zero game I've ever seen. Because they still hold all of their inhibitor turrets thanks to the wave clear of Victor and Graves. And it's still only 9,000 gold. It's heavily in the favor of NRG at this point as he completes his banner.
Banner of command. I love it. Let's see
this
again.
They need it to push,
yes,
actually.
I was going
to
say that. They finally found it.
Yeah. This kind of goes to show you how far NRG are ahead. The main DPS can flash after support away from the fight, and then you go back to the main fight and everything is still okay. Here, Impact gets to go incredibly deep. There's so many walls in the jungle. Impact finds the right angle to get double lift. He again falls, I think, to that bomb. And the rest of NRG can just continue the chasing. There's just not quite enough damage. This game could go so differently if just a few kills had fallen in the side of TSM, because you can see how close they are with the damage on these guys. But as of now, NRG is just running away with this game very, very well with this really utility-focused, tank-based team composition.
It's crazy. It just kind of hit you so hard, it makes your head spin. You don't really know how to get back from it. Aegis, as we said, one formed into a locket here, another formed into the Banner of Command so that NRG can now work off the ball. And Doublelift starts baking up some cupcakes here to try and protect the base. But they're just inviting for Impact.
Yeah.
They're just saying, okay, Impact. Moon's gonna go in right on to Yellow Star. Take him down. Glacial Fisher's out, but they're already past it. That's Doublelift and Yellow down. Svenskeren is going to fall after the repel comes down. The auto attack of Conquan. Are they giving it to Impact? Who are they giving it to? Takes him down with the chocolate bar. What other way would you want to go? It's going to be the inhibitor now, and I think they're looking at the Nexus.
Bannered minions, Baron, another quick kill on a double of two, has now fallen five times in this game, and an 18 kill to zero shutout statement game for NRG. About to close up here.
What a play. 31 and a half minutes into the game. 60,000 to 47,000 gold, and it's NRG Esports taking down TSM.
Wow. I think it's safe to say 19 kills to